So why this video? First, over the past decade, I've become a big fan and user of biochar. As I worked to educate myself, I found biochar videos can be broken into two camps. Scholarly versus layman videos showing how to make it but without following up on charging it or actually using it. In this video and three that will follow, I'll do my best to concisely do four things. One, speak to what biochar actually is. Two, show the simplest way I found to create it. And my best guess is I've made about 500 gallons to date. Three, show several methods for quickly charging biochar. And four, show multiple biochar methods actually put to use. In this first video, I'll be defining what biochar actually is, what it can do, and explain how it may work numerous miracles for you or may not, depending on your location and soils. So what is biochar? The initial key building block for biochar is often wood charcoal, though many other organic materials can be used as long as they are burned in a low oxygen environment and not allowed to turn to ash. I should also stress that the wood charcoal I use is lump charcoal and not briquette charcoal, as they contain additives such as lime, cornstarch, clay, coal, borax, and are purposely compressed. Lump charcoal created from wood serves so well because of the pores it contains, giving it much surface area capacity. Charcoal has an incredible number of pores and plate structures. To speak to just how much surface area is created by these pores and plates, a square inch can hold the surface area of up to a football field. The easiest way for me to wrap my mind around biochar is to think of it as a miraculous battery, but a battery when first created that holds no charge. If used without charging, it'll suck up moisture and nutrients from the surrounding soils for at least one full growing season, so if you don't charge it, it will do damage to the plants in your area that you try to use it. The inability for anything to grow in areas where I burn limbs and paper trash is actually what drew my attention to biochar in the first place, as I had areas that would lay completely dormant for one season where nothing would grow. And then, the second year, I would walk outside, look at the same area, and there'd be extremely lush growth that would be 4 to 5 times higher than the surrounding vegetation. The incredible growth I saw after a year without any growth was due to the char in the soil becoming charged and allowing plant roots to pull moisture and nutrients from the char as needed. With so much nutrient and water holding capacity, another way to think about char structure is as a microbe apartment high-rise that pairs wonderfully when it's married with compost. The great news is that charging doesn't need to take a year. It can be done in days, weeks, or months using various methods. Again, these will be spoken to in another video. A little biochar really can go a long way. Numerous studies speak to using 10 to 15% biochar in mixtures with soil as a starting point. Many users of biochar also recommend using small amounts and adding additional amounts in following years. Incorporating 10% into the top 6 inches of topsoil, 10 gallons of biochar can treat a 5x5 foot area. 50 gallons of biochar can treat an 11x11 foot area. And 170 gallons of biochar can treat a 21x21 foot area. I personally use biochar often with potted plants, and this is one of the places where biochar really can go a long way. When using 3-gallon pots, 10 gallons of biochar can be used to amend 33 pots worth of soil mixture. Biochar will be around long after you are gone. One of the great things about biochar is how long-lasting the effects can be. Studies of Terra Preta soils in the Brazilian Amazon basin estimate the age of the soils to be between 500 and 2,000 plus years old. So the benefits of biochar you add to your soils today will long outlive your own lifespan. Studies continue to show very interesting additional benefits of biochar. First, some studies are showing that biochar actually can serve as a jail cell for toxins, drawing the toxins into the biochar structure, but making them actually less bioavailable to plants, whereas the plants can still draw nutrients and water as needed. Studies are also showing that biochar can effectively reduce greenhouse gases such as nitrous oxide and methane by both storage in the biochar structure as well as increased pH levels with biochar, making the soils better able to incorporate nitrogen and nitrogen uptake by plants. So is biochar for everyone? Well, the poorer your soils are, the more benefit biochar likely will offer. However, if you live in an area where you have volcanic soils that for thousands of years have captured organic materials breaking down, biochar is much less likely to be effective. Many studies also showed that biochar can raise pH levels. So if you're living in an area with acidic soil, such as my own, that range from 5.2 to 5.5 on average, any increases in pH are going to be welcome. However, if you're living in an area with very base soils, you may want to very carefully weigh whether or not biochar should be used. Next thing I want to talk about is biochar size considerations. Personally, I have to admit, I don't try to aim for perfection. I'm not measuring biochar size particles. I just break it down as best I can. However, if you buy commercially produced biochar, it tends to be very small. On average, it's less than 1 millimeter. And then 1 millimeter would be approximately the size of pencil lead in a wooden pencil. There are trade-offs in size. Smaller particles will very effectively hold nutrients, but can have less water holding capacity. Some studies show in areas prone to drought that slightly larger particles, or particles that vary in size, help slow drainage and increase water holding capacity. Again, I want to stress that my use, I tend to not break down to extremely small particles, and on average, I would say that the particle I aim for a half inch or smaller size, and it's quite varied. And when I show the video that shows the method I actually use for breaking up my biochar, it'll become very evident that it ranges quite a bit in size, yet still proves to be quite effective. I want to finish by speaking to the videos that will follow this video. In as straightforward videos as I possibly can make, I'll have one that will show the methods I use to create charcoal for the biochar. I'll then publish a video showing how I charge biochar. And finally, I will follow up with a video that shows how I use biochar with potted plants, garden areas, and even for mulching small to medium-sized trees. I also hope that the videos I share will help show how holistic land management practices benefit not only the land, but also the local wildlife population in general. On the wildlife note, please feel free to check out my channel, as the majority of videos I've posted are outdoor related, be it trail camera captures or time spent on local waters. Thank you.